Most people, when you say Arabia, they think camels, terrorism, pirates, oil and gas. They don't think coral reefs or sharks. So I proposed a story to National Geographic magazine to kind of change that, you know, because Arabia, you know, is home to some of the most incredible marine ecosystems on our planet. You know, fortunately, the story was approved and off I went, you know, at the same time as the Arab Spring was going on. So my timing on these stories is not ideal, but nonetheless, you know, the Arabian Peninsula, and we covered parts of the African coast as well, the Red Sea, the Gulf of Aden, the Arabian Sea, and then the Persian Gulf. We began in the Gulf of Aden on the Somali-Djibouti border, sandwiched between pirates and the Western naval forces hunting the pirates. There is an aggregation of whale sharks, which nobody knows about. And every year, these young juvenile whale sharks aggregate to feed. Whale sharks have fingerprints just like us, and you can identify them, you know, by looking at the spot pattern on them. And each whale shark is completely unique with the spot pattern. So after a week or two, I think there was almost more than 100 different whale sharks feeding in that larger area. The biggest danger for a photographer here is becoming a whale shark sandwich. And then you get this sort of, you know, these guys actually suck the water in. It's this incredible, you know, stationary feeding, gulping behavior. I also spent a lot of time with the local Somali and Afari fishermen because I wanted to document their relationship with the ocean. I spent many nights out at sea with them. And then one night after midnight, they go, hey, you know, we sometimes have lots of whale sharks around our boat at night. And I go, whale sharks don't feed at night. They go, yes, they do. These guys have these sort of lights on their boats. And with those lights, they attract small plankton, which attracts bait fish. And they catch these bait fish with nets. And then they use the bait to catch, on a hook, to catch larger fish. And the whale sharks love the free, you know, meal of plankton. And they rub up against the boats. And I'm going, I have to take this picture. No one had actually documented this before. So I go on the water and I'm using my flashes and they ruin the complete nighttime ambience. And the whale sharks don't like him. And then I shoot without them, but the lights on these boats are just way, way too dim. You know, luckily, I come prepared. And, you know, at night, you know, we park the big boat next to the small fishing boats and we turn on the light. And the light attracts little plankton, which attracts big plankton, which attracts little fish, which attracts bigger fish. And then after an hour or two, it attracted the world's biggest fish. It's kind of weird because it's hard to, you know, get a perspective of size with whale sharks, but these are actually juveniles. This is an aggregation of subadults. Now, at first, I was disappointed. Oh, they're just small whale sharks, just 100 of them. That sucks. I wish they were bigger. When I was taking the images, having them small actually made all the difference because, you know, you're underwater. All you have is this very thin cone of light, and you're in the dark, and all you can see is these whale sharks moving in and out of the light like ships, you know, looming in and out of the fog. And then you get pictures like this, you know, just kind of just coming out of the gloom. But I really wanted a picture of the whale shark more interacting with the light. I did this for day after day, and at the end, I got this frame. You know, the whale shark was vertically suction feeding for about a half an hour in that position. So this was, you know, anybody could have taken that picture because he stood there for that long. Not much skill. You point and shoot. Not much skill in there. But with a larger whale shark, I would have gotten a fin or half a head. So it's only because these guys are juveniles. That is the only reason I was able to get this picture. You know, from the Gulf of Aden, Saudi Arabia. You know, my interest was mainly up on the Iraq-Iran-Kuwait border. My mother despairs every time she finds out where my next assignment is. And of course, you know, armed guards wherever I went, you know, and this is a world of mud. Mud, mud, and more mud, and we had to use a hovercraft. Star Wars, right? I mean, come on. In a hovercraft, it was just like crazy. And why did I go there? Well, I wanted to photograph the animal that made these. Now, these are very, very tiny mud walls. But in a desert environment like this, they're lifesavers, because basically they retain water. And the animal that made them are mudskippers. Not your normal garden variety mudskipper, Arabian mudskippers. That big and this thick. And they do these incredible courtship displays. They leap as high as they can. Whichever male leaps the highest gets the female, I think. They also have these cool fighting displays. You know, they puff each other up and they raise the dorsal and they just stare at each other and then they do all these sort of, you know, for these pictures, you lie in the mud for an hour before these fish come out of the hole. So you are stationary for days to get, you know, these little glimpses. But yeah, I love these guys. Like, oi! You can hear him screaming, right? That's my female mudskipper, or whatever. Anyway, let's move on. You know, I moved on to turtles and then the Arabian Sea. And as I was shooting all this great biodiversity, I'm going, hang on, I'm not seeing any sharks. After the whale sharks, I hadn't seen a single other shark. I went, what's going on here? And I figured it out when I was, you know, in Oman photographing seasonal kelp forest communities at Salala. And one evening I was, and there's a little place called Mirbat. It's this place that kind of time forgot. It's this sort of old school Arab fishing village. And there's this wall of people at the port. And I kind of, you know, gently elbow my way through, you know. And as the crowd parts, I see this. This is about 93 silky sharks. This is one boat's load, and every hour another boat arrives and offloads exactly the same number of sharks. So the one night I was there, I think it must have been 1,000 silky sharks. And then they auction everything off. And then at the end of the auction, all the sharks are loaded into these freezer trucks, and they're taken away. And I wanted to know where, so I started following these trucks. I ended up in these ice houses. Now, these trucks are not freezer trucks. They're insulated, but they're badly insulated. So every, you know, few hundred kilometers, they have to restock with ice. And that's where they kind of, you know, barter the sharks and resell them. And there I found out that in actual fact, all these sharks are going to Dubai. So I went to Dubai. And there I saw, you know, dozens of Omani trucks offloading large Arabian Sea sharks. And, you know, fins are only cut off there. And the meat goes to Bangladesh, it goes to Pakistan, it goes to Sri Lanka for consumption. It's the cheapest sort of marine protein there is. And the fins are exported to Asia for royal sums and princely sums. And it appears that over the last couple of years, Dubai has become the fourth largest exporter of shark fins to Hong Kong in the world. And that has, you know, had really sort of bypassed most of the scientific literature that I'd reviewed. So this was a massive surprise to actually be able to document this trade route across the Great Arabian Desert. And, you know, went to Hong Kong afterwards, and I tried to track these fins all the way to Hong Kong. There's a street in Hong Kong that basically is dedicated only to shark fin and dried seafood. I think there's 140 different shops, you know, Shark Fin City. And that's where I found my sharks, you know, dried in the shops. You know, the article was published in 2012. A lot of conservation issues were addressed in it, and, you know, it kind of really began a conversation in the Middle East as well about how to better manage one's shark fisheries.